Good morning, dear students. Today we'll be discussing about the next disease. So we'll begin with the protozoan diseases. So the first protozoan disease that we would be studying today is amebiasis. So as with all the other diseases we have studied, we'll study a brief background about that particular disease, how it is classified, how that particular organism is classified, the structure of the protozoan, cultural characteristics, pathogenicity, pathogenesis, symptoms, diagnosis, prophylaxis, and treatment. Okay. So before we begin, we will first know what are these protozoans. Many of you would be knowing, so just to brush up whatever you have learnt earlier. So protozoa are basically single-celled eukaryotes. They can either be free-living or parasitic, and they feed on organic matter such as other microorganisms or other organic tissues, and also on certain debris of the tissues. Okay. So these protozoa were earlier regarded as single-celled animals because they behaved or they possessed certain characteristics similar or certain behavior similar to that of animals, like motility, predation. Okay. So because of this, they were considered under animals, or they were considered as single-celled animals. So this is about the protozoa. So the disease what we would be studying today is amebiasis. So what is this amebiasis? It is caused by the organism. Causative organism is Entamoeba histolytica. Okay. So it is an infection of the large intestine of humans by the protozoan, that is Entamoeba histolytica. And the distribution of this disease is worldwide, and these infect mainly the humans. So humans are the main reservoir and source of infection for amebiasis. And this particular organism, when we see a brief morphology about this organism, they are microscopic and they live as endoparasites in the upper part of the large intestine of humans. Okay. So endoparasites are basically the parasites that inhabit the inner internal organs of the human body. It inhabits those mucus and submucus layers of the large intestine, and it mainly feeds on the tissues of the intestinal walls. So when it feeds on the intestinal wall tissues, what happens? It results in ulcers and abscesses of the liver and the intestine. Okay. So the liver is affected in severe cases or in the chronic cases. So during chronic cases, what happens? These Entamoeba histolytica enter the blood circulation and they start to affect the other organs of the body, like the liver, lungs, and also the brain. And it can cause serious and often fatal disease, which is what is referred to as the amoebic dysentery or amebiasis. Okay. So when we look at the classification of this organism, it belongs to the genus Entamoeba, and this genus Entamoeba has many other species that colonize humans apart from Histolytica, but all of them are not associated with the disease. Okay. So among all of these, only Entamoeba is histolytica is well recognized as a pathogenic amoeba, which is associated with both intestinal and extra-intestinal infections. So other morphologically identical Entamoeba species include Dispar, Moshkovsky, and Bangladeshi. Okay. So these are the other species of Entamoeba genus. So this is the structure of the protozoan, that is Entamoeba histolytica. So these protozoans have a life cycle during which the mature protozoan develops, or they have different cystic stages wherein they exist as cysts or in an inactive form and develop to the mature protozoan form, that is, which is able to cause the disease. Okay. So in case of Entamoeba histolytica, it exists in two distinct forms. The one is the magna or the trophozoid form, and the other is the minuta or the precystic form. So in the diagram, as you see here, you can see both the forms. So we'll see what are the morphological features of these two forms. The mature parasite or active and motile adult is what is referred to as the trophozoid. So this trophozoid has an ectoplasm. The transparent layer just below the plasma lemma, what you see is the ectoplasm layer, that is clear, non-granular, and it is hyaline. Whereas the endoplasm layer, the inner granular layer, what you see is the endoplasm. So these endoplasmic layer comprises of granules and it is fluid like. And in the trophozoid form, you can also see the pseudopodium or the pseudopodia, that are short, broad, rounded and finger like, and they are mainly composed of ectoplasm. So this, the rapidly advancing end of the body of this trophozoid form consists of the single clear pseudopodium. Okay, so this single clear pseudopodium is referred to as monopodial in nature. Monopodial refers to the presence of a single pseudopodium, and also the movement of this particular trophozoid form or the entamoeba with the help of the single pseudopodium in a single direction by crawling movement. Okay, and the endoplasm here also contains certain food vacuoles and also the nucleus. So what does these food vacuoles contain? They contain the stored food material, or they have the tissue fragments, erythrocytes, leukocytes, and also some ingested bacteria, because these are basically endoparasites. They feed on all the tissue and debris inside the host. And it also contains a nucleus that is round, and it is composed of a delicate membrane and small peripheral chromatin granules, and also it contains a centrally located nucleolus. Okay, so this nucleolus is surrounded by an indefinite clear area, which is referred to as the halo. And the characteristic or the unique features of these food vacuoles that are present in the trophozoid form is that these contain RBCs, because these trophozoid forms have the capacity of ingesting the RBCs, which is not seen in any other intestinal amoebae of the humans. Okay, so this is one of the characteristic features of Entamoeba histolytica. So whatever morphological structures that you have seen for trophozoid form is also true for the minuta form, except that the only difference where it is seen is that it is smaller in size and it does not have pseudopodium, or the pseudopodium is very less developed as compared to that of the trophozoid form, and these do not contain the food vacuoles or the contractile vacuoles. And these minuta form lives in the lumen of the intestine, and they are rarely found in the tissues. So these trophozoid forms are the ones that have the capability of invading the other organs apart from the site of infection. And these minuta form undergoes encystation. So we'll see what is this encystation in the later slides. and this helps in the transmission of the parasite from one host to the other. So when we look at the cultural characteristics of this Entamoeba species, basically two types of culture media are available for the isolation of Entamoeba species, that is xenic and azenic media. So based on the different species, either of these can be used. So what is the xenic cultivation? It is the cultivation of the parasite in the presence of certain undefined or unknown microbial flora. Okay, so in the presence of these microbial flora, these parasites are cultivated. And azenic cultivation is the growth of the parasite in the absence of these undefined or unidentified unknown flora, except that protozoan which is intended to be grown. Okay, so apart from that protozoan that is to be grown, any other flora can be used for the growth of this parasite. So this is what is referred to as the azenic cultivation. So this culture of Entamoeba histolytica is, as a diagnostic procedure, has very poor sensitivity when compared to that of microscopy, and it is also technically difficult and also expensive and difficult to maintain. And hence whatever current culture methods have not been listed in the ideal diagnostic tests that are available for the diagnosis of amoebiasis. So here you can see the examples of some of the xenic cultivation media and also azenic cultivation media. So azenic cultivation media is what is suitable for the growth of Entamoeba histolytica. So when we look at the pathogenicity of this organism, wherein we will be studying about the life cycle of Entamoeba histolytica. So we'll see what are the different stages in the life cycle of this Entamoeba histolytica. It basically has three different stages, that is encystment and transfer to a new host and excystment. Okay, so we'll see what happens in each of these three stages or these three phases of the life cycle of Entamoeba histolytica. So these we'll first see with the encystment. As you can see here, the different stages have been numbered, so we'll go according to that. So whenever I'm explaining, you can see in the diagram and correlate to that. So the precystic forms remain small and live only in the intestinal lumen. So just before encystment, what happens? The parasites round up by eliminating the food vacuoles and accumulate food materials in the form of glycogen and blood-like chromatoid granules. So further, each of these parasites secretes a thin, rounded, resistant and colorless transparent cyst wall around it. Okay, so this is the formation of the cystic form. Encystment actually refers to the formation of the cyst from the mature trophozoite form. Okay, so that is what you are seeing here in step 1. So what happens in this stage? The trophozoite form will eliminate the food vacuoles and they will accumulate all the food materials in the form of glycogen and chromatoid granules that are required to stay in the cyst form. Okay, so this cysts of Entamoeba can vary in size from 10 to 20 microns in diameter. And this cyst has a cytoplasm that is clear, and each cyst is mononucleate at this stage. So it will have a single nucleus. And the presence of this chromatoid bodies or the chromatoid granules is the characteristic feature of these cysts. Okay, so they can occur either singly or in multiples of two or more. So there can be aggregates of these cysts in either multiples of two or four. The nucleus of this cyst then divides twice, so that each cyst now becomes tetranucleate. Okay, so one cyst that is dividing twice to become tetranucleate, and that is what you are seeing here in the step one, having four nucleoli. Okay, and at this stage the cyst is infective to a host. Okay, so it has the capability to infect a new host, and these encysted forms pass out with the fecal matter of the host. So this is the beginning stage of the life cycle of Entamoeba histolytica. Okay, so after this, the cystic stage will be, or the cystic form will be transferred to the new host. So these infective cysts, then what happens, they will remain in the viable form for a considerable amount of time outside the human intestine. So then infection of the fresh host takes place when the food food is containing these cysts are swallowed, or they are consumed by the host. So what are the carriers of these cysts? Especially the houseflies and cockroaches act as the carrier of these cysts. So when these houseflies and cockroaches carry the cyst and contaminate from, when these houseflies and cockroaches, what they do, they carry the cyst from the feces of the infected person, and they again drop these cysts on the foots. So the foods get contaminated, and when such contaminated food is consumed, then the another or the new host can, who is consuming this food, can develop the amoebiasis. And there are also certain food handlers that are sometimes responsible when their nails contain this cyst, and when these cysts come in contact with the food material, it can result in contamination of the food and further infect the host, new host. And these infective cysts pass into the lower portion of the small intestine of the new host. So that is the next stage. So whatever you see in the second step is the ingestion of the mature cysts by the new host, and the colors, whatever you see here, the blue color is non-invasive colonization. So it will remain at the site wherever it is being, wherever it is the site of infection, it will remain there and cause the disease. And the next one, the yellow colored, what you see is the intestinal disease when it becomes invasive, or when it enters the intestine. And see, whatever you're seeing here is the disease or the abscesses of the lungs and brain. So these symptoms of whatever you're seeing here in different colors, we'll be studying in the symptoms part. Okay, so the next one is the excisement stage, or the excisement phase. In this process of excistation, what happens, a single tetranucleate amoeba emerges from a cyst. So when the cyst has been ingested, in the third step, whatever you are seeing here, a single tetranucleate amoeba emerges from the cyst through a minute pore in the cyst wall. Okay, and this tetranucleate amoeba now produces a new generation of trophozoites. So here what you are seeing in the fourth step, so the new generation of trophozoites are generated by diverse series of nuclear and cytoplasmic divisions, resulting in the production of 8 uninucleate amoebae. Okay, So these are called as metacystic trophozoites. These feed on the contents of the intestine, and then they grow in size to form the trophozoites of the next generation. Okay, so directly from these uninucleate amoebae, they develop into the trophozoites of the next generation. And these trophozoites stay in the lumen of the intestine for a particular period of time. When they may attack the wall of the intestine, and then they can start the life cycle again. Okay, so this is what happens in the life cycle of Entamoeba histolytica. So when we look at the pathogenesis, what happens, like in the molecular level, what is happening is what we will look in the pathogenesis part of Entamoeba histolytica infection. So whatever you are seeing here in this diagram, the four different stages of infection is what is mentioned here: uninfected stage and asymptomatic colonization in the mucus layer, colitis and disseminated infection into the portal veins. So we'll see each of these steps, and we'll see what are the molecular mechanisms that have been affected in the host by these Entamoeba histolytica. So these exostation or the trophozoites emerge from the lumen of the terminal ileum. So when there is exostation happening in the lumen of the gut, okay, or the trophozoites are emerging. So once these trophozoites emerge, what happens? With the help of adherence lectin, that is GAL or GALNAC, they are able to attach to the mucosal layer, and after adhesion, in some cases what happens, they can colonize the mucus layer and shed cysts into the lumen again. Okay, so as and when they are infecting the mucus layer, they can also release cysts to the lumen layer. Okay, so in symptomatic cases, what happens? These amoebae degrade the mucosal layer. They will colonize in the mucus layer, which is the symptomatic stage. And in the symptomatic stage, what happens? These will degrade the mucus layer in part and by activities of the protease, and by a process called trogocytosis, they can invade the lamina propria region of the intestine. Okay, so that is where they can be infective, or they can be invasive, and they cause colitis, that is inflammation of the colon. So after this, what happens? The trophozoites can further disseminate to the portal veins, and once they disseminate into the portal veins, they infect the liver, and it can lead to liver abscess. Liver abscess is the collection of pus and inflammation of the liver in very severe cases. So the infection outcome can be variable, and invasive disease can happen for more than 1 year of asymptomatic colonization. So these are the different factors that you are seeing here: the pathogen factors, host factors, and the environment in the gut, and how they are affected, and what is the infection outcome. So when we look at the symptoms tend to appear 1 to 4 weeks after ingestion of the cyst. So according to the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, it is said that only about 10 to 20% of the people who have amoebiasis will become ill from the disease. otherwise it is very mild and asymptomatic. So the symptoms at this stage also is very mild, and it can include loose stools and stomach cramping. If this parasite further invades the lining of the intestine, then it can result in amoebic dysentery. So the mild symptoms include abdominal cramps, diarrhea, fatigue, excessive gas, rectal pain, and also unintentional weight loss. So these are symptoms that are mild in case of amoebic dysentery, whereas the severe symptoms include abdominal tenderness, bloody stools, fever, and also vomiting. So if the parasite invades the intestine, then it can lead to bloody stools. So what happens next? Once amoebic dysentery progresses further, then the entamoeba histolytica may be drawn into the portal circulation, and it can also enter the liver. In the liver, the parasites settle, they attack the liver tissue and form the abscesses. That is, the collection of pus happens in the liver. So the patient has pain in the liver region, very high fever, and also high leukocyte number. Shifted to this slide. Okay, so this slide shows the symptoms of the liver abscess, that is pain in the liver, fever, and also high leukocyte number. And the lung abscesses are caused when there is direct extension from the liver abscesses through the movement from the diaphragm. Okay, so then the lung abscesses usually rupture into the bronchial tube, and so through this bronchial tube a discharge of brown mucoid material happens, which is then coughed up along with the sputum. So sometimes these parasites also form abscesses in the brain, and these are in very severe conditions, and abscesses anywhere else in the body is not recorded. So when we look at the diagnosis, or the how to diagnose these entamoeba histolytica, there are many methods that are available. So one is the microscopic detection, wherein we'll be examining or observing these trophozoites or cystic forms from the stool samples under the microscope and look for these entamoeba species by staining them. Okay, so what happens when fresh stool is taken and they are made with a wet mount and they are permanently stained with certain chromogenic substrates like trichrome. So microscopy also has low sensitivity if only one stool sample is analyzed, and hence requires personnel who have been trained with morphological diagnosis. So without this, microscopic detection becomes insensitive or less sensitive for diagnosis. So the other immunological methods that have been available for the diagnosis of amoebiasis. So one is the antibody detection or indirect hemagglutinin test that has been replaced commercially by the available enzyme immunoassay kits for routine serodiagnosis of amoebiasis. So the antigen consists of a crude soluble extract of acinically cultured organisms. The other one is the antigen detection, wherein the antigen detection may be useful as an adjunct to microscopic diagnosis in detecting the parasites, and also it helps to distinguish between the pathogenic and the non-pathogenic infections. And the other molecular diagnosis methods that are available include conventional PCR, So conventional PCR based assays, it is available for discriminating between Entamoeba histolytica and Entamoeba dispar. So to differentiate between these two species, conventional PCR can be used, because apart from histolytica, the other species are, they until now they are not known to have any pathogenicity. So it is only to differentiate between the other species and to make a differential diagnosis. And another PCR that is available is real-time Tachman real-time PCR approach that has been available for validation and also for the differential diagnosis of amoebiasis. So this particular assay targets the 18S rRNA gene with species-specific Tachman probes. So these Tachman probes are specific to Entamoeba histolytica or any other species, and if it has, what to say, if it has complementary sites on the 18S rRNA, then it will bind and it gives a fluorescent signal in real-time PCR, which indicates positive or negative results. So when we look at the epidemiology or the distribution of this amoebiasis, it is distributed worldwide, particularly in the tropics and most commonly in areas of poor sanitation. So maintenance of sanitation is one of the major prophylactic measures so as to control amoebiasis. And outbreaks among men is also common who have physical contact. And people are at high risk for severe disease are those who are pregnant or who are immunocompromised or receiving corticosteroids. So basically, immunocompromised persons are at high risk of these infections or for any other infections for that matter. So what are the prophylactic measures that can be taken to control amoebiasis? Basically, it is all these prophylactic measures, whatever you see here, refers to sanitation, okay? Maintenance of hygiene and sanitation. So sanitary disposal of fecal matter, then perfect sanitation and protection of water and vegetables from pollution, then washing of hands with antiseptic soap and washing water before touching the food, washing hands before touching the food, and cleanliness in preparing the food, and also washing the vegetables and other raw materials properly before it is being cooked. So treatment, are there any chemotherapy available for this? Yes. So several antibiotics are available to treat amoebiasis. So to treat acute and subacute dysentery, emetin is given orally, and other antibiotics that can be given orally and are more effective include fumagillin, teramycin, erythromycin and oreomycin. And based on the severity or for chronic cases, arsenic compounds such as carbazone, thiocarbazone and viofoam are given, and certain iodine compounds like yttrium, diodoquine and viofoam are also given. And metronidazole and tinidazole are most significant advancements in the treatment of both luminal and also tissue amoebicides. So this is about amoebiasis. Thank you. If you have any doubts, you can post it in the course chat and we can discuss there.